It is 15 after 9. Thanks for being with us on Live at 9. He is a fan of Elvis Presley. He has been for decades, but he's also a music producer and historian. He turned his interest in the king of rock and roll into, quite frankly, an art form.
From researching Elvis's daily life, helping get the king's music to new audiences, and so much more, Ernst Jorgensen is known as the foremost scholar of Presley's life, and fans will have a chance to see and hear from him at Graceland this week. But first, he's here with us. Thank you for joining
us. Thank you for giving us some time.
For having me here.
Of course. So, my number one biggest question is, how much does this consume you? You know, you've been studying over the years, and I just really would like to know, how much does this consume you?
But, you know, I'm confronted with it in my daily life,
yeah,
with people asking me questions, so it is rather all-consuming. But I have a life.
Yeah.
I live in the country, and I have a wife and kids.
And they get tired of hearing about Elvis?
Yeah.
They'd
rather have some money.
Right.
Well, fortunately, knowing about Elvis can help you earn some.
Yeah,
was it that made you first fall in love with him? How old were you?
Oh, that was the typical teenage thing. You needed some way of identification.
Yeah.
And in Denmark, there was before Beatles and Stones, where Elvis and Cliff Richard, and Cliff Richard was a little bit of, you know, for a boy, he was too cute. So Elvis standing in front of Graceland and his Rolls Royce, hey, that's who I want to be.
Because he got the girl, right?
So well, at that time I settled for the Rolls Royce.
So were your parents, you know, because over here he made such a, I guess, you know, stir with parents and his hips gyrating and all that on the Ed Sullivan show. And was he a shock to your parents in Denmark,
that's
older generation?
That's a truly brilliant question, in that the perception is that it's all like it was in America.
Yeah.
But in Europe, rock and roll didn't happen to the same extent. In little conservative countries like Denmark, you couldn't buy Elvis until 59.
Really?
So a lot of Europeans became Elvis fans, not because of rock and roll, but because of It's Now or Never, I Lonesome Tonight, His Latest Flame,
really?
You know, Surrender.
Kind of the more ballad.
So that is very interesting, not so much just for the fact of it, but that Elvis cannot be explained by just having been part of that sexual, social revolution in America.
Right. Well, and he had so many aspects to him, like the gospel, the movies. He had quite a good acting talent, though he was not able really to explore it. But right. I've talked to producers of his films who said he really had potential to do so much more in that. He was so multifaceted.
But the money was somewhere else.
Yeah.
The money was in the musicals.
Well, in the Colonel.
Well, the Colonel
organized
that, and you can, artistically, you can argue that, but it made a lot of money for them.
Right, right. So after all these years of studying him, is there anything that still surprises you, or any new thing that you find still today?
Yeah, I did a box set just a few years ago called A Boy from Tupelo, and it's a big book like this, and when we printed it, and was ready, and the CDs were ready, including all known recordings of Elvis Presley from 53 to 55.
Wow.
Suddenly, a track I never heard of turned up on the internet.
Uh-huh.
Just the same week. I was like, I wanted to shoot myself.
Like, what's going on?
And you see at auctions, like at Graceland, where they have the auctions every year, that certainly new things pop up.
Yeah.
People have photos. Very few recordings turn up, unfortunately, almost none. But photos of Elvis that show different angles to him, photos of Elvis at the age of 17 where he's wearing a jacket that must have looked very unusual to most people. I mean, he was already speculating about who he wanted to be before he was anywhere close to being Elvis.
Yeah, he was
Elvis
a trendsetter
Presley.
Before he knew what that
Absolutely.
Was.
Absolutely.
And you mentioned CDs, and we were showing some of these right here on camera. What are these?
Well, this is, you know, this is a fan's dream or a historian's dream. When Elvis made his comeback in 1969 after the TV show and in the ghetto, and he went to Vegas and he started this engagement, RCA thought, hey, let's make a live record. They recorded 11 consecutive shows. And that's what that
so
is. So you
can
sit there and listen to 11 shows. Some of the material has never been released before. Some has not been released in this form. There's a whole book with it. But, you know, as a fan, whether, you know, it would be Elvis or it would be Michael Jackson
this
or Prince,
in general,
to get 11 concerts that's just a dream.
Is he the greatest who ever lived in his genre or his world?
Well, you can always argue on that. I think what is very important is that no artist ever had had the intention of the world that he did. We all had an opinion about Elvis Presley because it was a very simplistic world compared to the fragmented world of today.
Right.
It's like, yeah, we either hated him, liked him, disregarded him, but we definitely knew who Elvis was.
Well, and even today, in our fragmented world, he's still...
It's a reference all over the world. Oh, I'm the local Elvis.
It's amazing.
Yeah, I'm not.
But if you dyed that hair, thank you so much, and did the little pompadour thing. All right, we've put on the screen two events that Ernst is a part of today, and we've got to let you get out of here, and Saturday, and then of course ElvisWeek.com. Mm-hmm. It's where everything's happening this week. Thank you so much for giving us some time. Such a pleasure.